this person has been granted asylum status, refugee status in the United Kingdom, and she shall be afforded all respect and privileges as though she were a citizen of the United Kingdom. This is the type of protection they're talking about. And it is not skewed in any particular direction to put a burden on one state. I was asked to speak about cooperation and partnership. This is the form of cooperation that the international community is doing. So, under the principle of common humanity, people who are fleeing a state which holds itself out to be a respecter of the rule of law has to extend that helping hand. That's what partnerships are doing. You don't close your doors. If you cannot cope with the pressures, you seek international assistance to help you implement your obligations. But at the same time, not all who seek refugee status or asylum status under the 1951 convention will be successful. The convention doesn't, and in December 2018, for example, a few weeks ago, 10th of December, the Global Compact for Migration was adopted, and it became the first intergovernmental non-binding agreement to cover all dimensions of international migration in a holistic and comprehensive manner. Current estimates are, current estimates show that there are 22.3 million refugees globally. That is why the United Nations had to act by adopting a political agreement, because it recognized that a number of these parties had failed to pass legislation in their countries to give effect or to implement the obligations under the 1951 Convention or its protocol. And this development began in 2015. It shows how slow the pace of multilateralism can be at times, and was adopted in 2018. And it is slow because you're dealing with so many countries, so many different civilizations, so many legal systems. So you try to get it as correct as possible. With the adoption of the Global Compact on Migration, Secretary General of the United Nations, Antonio Guterres, said, in the many places where fertility is declining and life expectancy is rising, economies will stagnate and people will suffer without migration. I repeat, in the many places where fertility is declining and life expectancy is rising, economies will stagnate and people will suffer without migration. It is clear that most developed countries need migrants across a broad spectrum of vital roles, from, for example, caring for the elderly to preventing the collapse of health services. The venerable, charismatic leader Angela Merkel of Germany, the German Chancellor, in speaking about the Global Compact on Migration, said, "The pact is worth fighting for." Yeah? The pact is worth fighting for. It is time that we finally take migration, that we finally tackle some immigration together. Again, speaking about cooperation. The pact is not legally binding, so the excuses some countries use that we will need a three-quarters majority or two-thirds majority to get laws, to get legislation, to implement its provisions, are not true with regard to this global compact. It's politically binding as opposed to legally binding, and consequently, it is tantamount, a little more than that, for a tantamount to a gentleman's agreement that you carry all the requirements of the global compact in good faith. Very significantly, it was adopted the same year that the international community commemorated the 70th anniversary of the adoption of the Declaration of Human Rights. The Global Compact sets out the cooperative framework for dealing with international migration. Signatories agree, for example, to limit the pressure on countries with many migrants and to promote the self-reliance of newcomers. The document states that no country can address migration alone while also upholding the sovereignty of states and the obligations of the international law. And we hear the notion of sovereignty and sovereignty and sovereignty. The Declaration and Convention do not disrespect or do not seek to annul the sovereign boundaries of states, no. It recognizes that in an interdependent, cooperative, multilateral arena, community of nations, global village, that you cannot allow the movement of people, asylum seekers, to be regulated by unscrupulous criminals who peddle their boats, who allow human smuggling to take place, who would pen little children into camps separated from their parents. That is contrary to the Global Compact on Migration. And it's no wonder that the United States is not a signatory to the Global Compact on Migration. But more importantly, I want to emphasize that states are not left by themselves to deal with the question. There's another organization called, which Trinidad Tobago is also a member of, the International Organization on Migration. It was established as long ago as 1951. It is a leading intergovernmental organization in the field of migration and works closely with governmental, intergovernmental, and non-governmental partners, almost covering every corner of the globe with 172 member states. The International Organization on Migration is dedicated to promoting humane and orderly migration for the benefit of all. It does so by providing services and advice. It does so by providing services and advice to governments and migrants upon request. So if you do not use your machinery out there, the representatives, to seek assistance and services and advice to assist you in addressing an inflow, if not an influx, of refugees or asylum seekers or migrants. You will stand alone. But the first thing you need to do is to get the best advice available. Without the best advice, you'll be in difficulty because you'll believe that there is no one to help you, and your citizens will be restless. They'll behave as though they're being whatever is available to them, services, whether healthcare and so on, are being taken away by others. But it doesn't have to be like that. That is why there's a need for seeking assistance under the very treaties that you have subscribed to. The International Organization on Migration works to help ensure the orderly and humane management of migration, to promote international cooperation on migration issues, and to assist in the search of practical solutions to migration problems, and to provide humanitarian assistance to migrants and other displaced persons. When one examines the 1951 Convention or its 1967 Protocol, one will not see any mention of climate change. But I want to, tonight, I want to indicate to you that climate change is not only about changing weather patterns and increasing the intensity of hurricanes and so on. There's a link between climate change and migration, very importantly, especially for SIDS, especially for small island developing states. Small island developing states have been identified as being on the front line of climate change. While the island's varying physical features and socio-economic characteristics, they all have a similar level of sustainable development and physical exposure, which together lead to extreme vulnerability to climate change. For example, with a large land mass, if there is unusual weather conditions or an earthquake in a particular region, people move to the river. If the earthquake, which struck Trinidad and Tobago and created fear among the population, I believe in my lifetime is the most fear I've ever seen the fact. If that earthquake was to destroy Trinidad and Tobago, where would the population go? Yeah? Or the flooding? The flooding was more widespread. The damage was more widespread. What would happen? In addition to large coastal populations, vulnerable subregions, vulnerable subgroups, the most at-risk persons in the event of migration due to climate change include the elderly, children, women, and impoverished communities, as well as the disabled. As sea level rise, along with coastal erosion, and I've been told by some colleagues of mine what is happening in Cyprus and Caicos, as sea level rise, along with coastal erosion, and more intense extreme events, increasingly, small island developing states have to put measures in place to deal with displacement of people. For those who are forced to move, where would they go? I remember a few years ago speaking to the ambassador of the Maldives. Maldives, it's a very small island, no violence. And what he told me is that they have a sovereign fund and they're going to purchase one of the Fiji islands in the event that climate change gets so serious that the population has to grow. So that's why I said this is a new development in terms of how we treat the refugees and asylum seekers. But in our Caribbean reality, deliberately or inadvertently for opportunistic reasons at times, tend to mix apples with oranges, tend to call a quantity an orange and so on. We have seen within recent time a growing number of Caribbean people in our territory. Some people call them migrants, some call them asylum seekers. But are the migrants or asylum seekers in the sense, within the meaning of what I have been speaking to you about for the last few minutes? They are not. The movement of CARICOM people within the context of the revised treaty of Chagaramas, establishing the Caribbean community, including the Caribbean single market and the economy, codifies, provides a formula, provides a means of treatment for CARICOM people who are fleeing, who are moving, I should say. Some are fleeing as well. Total free movement is what the Treaty of Chagaramas has devised and envisioned. We have not yet arrived to the place where all CARICOM nationals would be allowed to move freely. Certain categories have been allowed. Let me briefly peruse 2.5 of the important articles of the revised treaty. Article 45 of that treaty says, movement of community nationals is one of the areas member states commit themselves to the goal of free movement of nationals within the community. Article 46 goes on to say, without prejudice to the rights recognized and agreed elsewhere in the treaty, member states, Trinidad and Tobago and the other 14 member states, have agreed and undertake as a first step towards achieving the goals set out in the Article 45, to accord to the following categories of community nationals the right to seek employment in their jurisdictions: university graduates, media workers, sports persons, artists, musicians, as so recognized by the competent authorities of each member state. And I realize that since the Treaty of Chagaramas has revised was adopted and entered into force, the trajectories of those who are able to move freely have increased. The conference of the heads of government, CARICOM, goes on to say, shall keep the provisions of this article under review in order to A, enlarge as appropriate the classes of persons entitled to move and work freely in the community, and B, monitor and secure compliance with this provision. But despite legal architecture, whether based on a global treaty like the United Nations Convention and its protocol, or a regional treaty, there are always excuses, there are always pushbacks, there are always excuses